Welcome to Playing with Junk. Today we have a very special unit. It's a little bit big, a little bit too big to take it home. It's a IBM System Z9, a mainframe computer from 2005 or a little bit later. And I will take it apart today because this unit is going to the scrapyard. So, let's see what's inside. The door has an integrated noise reduction. There is everything foam coated. You see the fingerprints there from technicians that didn't care about the foam. Well, it could be from me. You see that. Here, some plastic decorative panel. And inside we have this. So on the top there is a space for the battery backup unit, which is now not used. Then we have DC converters, power supply, power input plug here, a big one. This system needs about 5.5 kilowatt of power. It's one of the smaller systems. You can see it here. There's only one CPU module. IBM calls this a book. There is space for 4 books. I don't know why they call it a book, because maybe because they stand here like books in a shelf. I'm not sure. The 2 black panels here. You can swing them out and fold them down. Normally you have 2 laptop computers here sitting on these trays. They are for diagnostic and maintenance purposes. They have already been removed because you have pretty nice notebook computers here. You can use them for whatever you want. So, as I said, we have here one book. One book consists of the CPU, memory and some I/O cards here. I made myself a little helping list with all these abbreviations and names of these things, because IBM always has a little bit different names on everything. I think that's just to confuse technicians from other companies. They call this MBA, memory bus adapters. We have 2 of them installed. The 2 buses go down to the I/O cage, which is here. As you see, the cables go here to this I/O input module. And then we have different modules like Ethernet, FireWire, all kind of stuff here. The other side is empty. It would be used if you have more than one book CPU module. Then on the base here, the high voltage power supplies, I assume. The manuals are not very detailed on power on this machine. There's more about CPU, processor, and why it is such a good machine. There is certainly a technical manual around, but I haven't found that. Now on the back side, there is also AC-DC converter, power cables, other cables, Ethernet for managing the system. There are more DC converters here, this time DC to DC converters. I haven't figured out what voltage they use, so we have a 200 volt voltage warning here, so I think we are going to have an input of maybe 300 volt DC. Then we have here OSC, that's the oscillator, the clock oscillator for the entire unit. Because if you have more than one CPU or a dozen of CPU, you have to make sure that the oscillators are accurate for all them together. There are two of them. If one oscillator fails, the other takes over. AFLE, I don't know what this is at the moment. Could also be an empty module. Then we have three empty bays here. So the whole system is made to be enlarged to a much bigger system. There's another I/O cage which is completely empty. So this is the... Oh, there's a big wrench to set the wheels or the brakes here. Nice one. I certainly will keep that. There is the model number. It is the type 2096. 2096 means this is a business class model. It comes with only one book installed. There are also enterprise class systems. You can have them fully equipped with four books, up to 64 processors, up to 500 gigabyte of memory. I will not say gigabyte now, because I learned that's wrong. Although some people found it very funny to say it like that. Okay, let's take out some stuff. So I have opened the covers of the power converters. This is the first board. Seems to be a DC-DC converter with a lot of big fuses here. I don't see the value. Maybe 8 amps? Don't know. Something that you have to see is there is a lot of free space on this board, because everything is made to stay cool, to have optimal airflow, to run forever, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. So this is built to run, not to fail. So this looks like power controller here. The entire system must be powered up by commands from the maintenance units. You cannot just switch the power, flip the power switch on and think it will boot. No, it's not that easy. So there are more DC converters in the shape of a memory, but it's of course some sort of power supply, some more big fuses. We have 3, 12, 12, I think that could be the amps. Very complex power supply with a lot of connectors. I assume these are even Ethernet connectors because the whole internal circuit are connected by Ethernet for command and control. So, and this is the high voltage power supply. I'd say input stage is around here. Yeah, you see here, input connector, three-phase fusing, 25 amps per fuse, two in parallel makes 50 amps, I assume. Then some input filtering, a lot of caps on a board, more input filtering, more caps, a relay. I'm missing the big rectifier, which is certainly under this huge heat sink. I mean, look at this. That's a heat sink. Primary capacitors. 450 volt. 940 microfarad. A little bit an odd value. Another filter coil. Then the whole switching and rectifier unit. I think I will take that heatsink away to see what's underneath. Then a lot of logic controllers, regulation, and the output connectors. As I said before, I assume the output will probably be somewhere about 200 or 300 volts DC. Let's see here. Input 380, so that's three phase input. Output 350 volt at 19 amps. Okay, that's a lot of power. Okay, I just decided not to take away that heatsink because I have to disassemble the entire power supply with a, I don't know, 2 dozen of screws, so I go directly for the CPU module. Now, this is what IBM calls a book. Here on the front you have the MBAs, the memory bus adapters. You can have up to 8 of them with only one CPU here. We only need 2 to connect the I/O buses. Then we have some memory. It's now populated with 2 gigabyte memories. I have seen that somewhere. Where is it? Oh no, here. It's only 1 gigabyte. And probably another one here. Yes. So that's 2 gigabyte of memory. Of course, there have been bigger modules. You can add more modules, depending on how much you need and how much your, or how full your pocket is of money. An interesting detail, you don't have the latches that are usual. You need a special tool to remove these modules. They have some kind of hooks down here. Maybe another way to tell people to leave their fingers away if they are not trained by them. So as you can see, we can have up to 8 memory modules with 4 DIMMs each. So that makes it possible to have quite a lot of memory here. And now let's go to the fun part, the CPU. If we have a closer look here, you see 9 holes here in the cover. They are all numbered. 1, 2, 3, 4. That's when you tighten the screws, you have to follow these numbers to tight the heatsink evenly to the processor socket. I call it socket. I don't know if that is the right expression for this, as you will see shortly. So I will unscrew that and we will see what's underneath that cover. Now all the screws are loosened. Now prepare for what comes now. Oops. Ta-da! That's the big one. You can see here the CPU cooler, which is screwed to the cover, so it comes off with the cover. Then we have a massive, really a massive copper plate here. The entire thing here is pure copper. We have a temperature sensor here, a lot of screws. It looks like a cylinder head of an airplane piston engine. And we have capacitors. We have big capacitors here. We have smaller ones here. We have more on this side, on the other side, and here too. So the entire board here is only the big chip and capacitors. And of course the memory modules, but there is not too much on the active side, no chips here, a little bit of a board, and then the connector to this I/O module cage here, which can be separated from the unit. Here is a big connector. Now let's have a look at the chip. Now the first step to remove the CPU is to loose the 4 screws here on the bottom. They are spring-loaded and you will see why. Oops, not with that knob. So that's the screws, heavy springs here. So let's have a closer look to that. We have here a land grid array with 5,184 pins. That's 5,100 and something connections to that chip. Now, this is not the backside of the chip itself. This is only the socket. It has here a clip. There is another clip. Which won't come off without the tool. Okay, second clip. And with the clips removed, we can take away that socket thing here, and that's the chip. Now, a little bit about this socket here. These are 5,184 little springs that go from one side to the other. This socket here is sandwiched between the board, that side, and the chip. And that's why we need these screws to hold them together firmly. Now, the springs here, I hope I can show that. Wait a moment. These springs here are not really springs, they are like little metallic sponges or however you call that. Let's see if I can take one out. Destroying the socket right now. So this is a bit a better position. You can see I can pull them out. And yeah, it's just a piece of wire that is wrinkled together into that hole. Let's see if we can get another one. Yes. So it's definitely not a perfect spring, but they will have their reasons to make it so. The material here is either gold, copper, so gold-plated copper. There are also sockets in this of this kind made of conductive plastics. The problem with them is they age and they get sticky, and if you want to remove the chip they will break and you need a new socket. And if you have an old system, for example like the old HP 9000 systems, you can't get new sockets, so you better never remove those CPU chips except you want to scrap them. So I wonder how they fiddle these springs here into these holes. Must be a very clever machine. I don't expect that they are doing it by hand. Yeah, that's the socket. Now let's do some heart surgery. As usual, everything works better with the right tools. We need a big Torx, not an Allen key. Makes life much easier. Okay, before I open it, a little detail. Maybe you have wondered that there is no thermal paste on this heat spreader and also on the heat sink. But there is a tiny layer of some silicon oil or something like that. And I think this is machined very well, so you don't actually need a huge amount of thermal compound, so there is more or less nothing on it. It's a huge area, so okay. Be prepared. What happens? Oops, all the washers fall down. Okay, that's the lower frame. That was mounted like that. Massive aluminium with some kind of gasket. So, and you already see my fingerprints. That's not what you should do if you want to reuse that. Now, okay, another gasket, and that's the chip with a lot of thermal compound. So, as you can see, the heat spreader here, this weighs about a kilo or so. It is machined from a massive block with all these extra connections to the chips and a lot of heat sink grease. Oops. There are the chips. I will clean that shortly and then I explain what it is here on this chip. Now I'm back from cleaning. It was quite a little bit an effort to clean that thermal paste away because it was not that type that dissolves easily with alcohol. So I had to mechanically scrape that away. And I have labeled the chip now, the chips. PU means processing unit. We have 8 of them. So it's an 8 processors. Each processor has 2 cores. In one manual they wrote that this is actually a dual core, and in the other manual they wrote that the 2 cores are working in parallel, so they are processing the same command in the same time. For redundancy, for safety. So if one core calculates something wrong, then the other core will correct that or something like that. You certainly will find some manuals in the internet. MSC is a memory storage controller. We have 2 of them. SD or the cache, they are data, and there's a data cache, level 1 and a level 2 cache, and instruction cache, all on these 4 chips here, so it's one cache chip for 2 CPUs. SC is a coherency control, so it's a control chip for the entire system here on this. And clock, it's a clock chip that distributes the clock signals correctly to those chips. And then we have a lot of tiny capacitors which break off here very easily. And they are a little bit funny. I hope I can show you that on camera. I hope you can see that. That's the chip capacitor. It has 4 rows of connectors that go
to the connecting points here. I think they're somehow soldered, but very, very weak. You can just twist them off like that. Very strange construction. I have never seen something like that before. And that's certainly something that even an IBM technician is not allowed to disassemble. So the whole unit with the heat spreader will probably never disassemble it after it is assembled in the factory. So isn't that a nice shot? You can see the camera. That's how it looks. Now some details about this chip. The ceramic substrate here has 102 layers, and it has inside about 540 meters of wiring. 102 layers, 540 meters, that's half a kilometer, or a third of a mile, if you like to have it like that. Yeah, and 5100 and something contacts here. The total amount of transistors in all this chip is 4.7 billion. So there are 4.7 billion transistors that must work correctly. And that's the heat spreader, a massive chunk of copper with a temperature sensor here. Yeah, that's the CPU. Let's have a look at the rest of the system. Well, let's see what comes up from these I/O card slots and how the power supplies look like. And I haven't seen the ventilators, the fans. I think they are directly underneath the book cage. We will see. IBM doesn't call these things fans, they call them AMD, air movement devices. I think it's about the same amount of letters than fan, and it has also the same function. That's the fan controller or fan electronics. Input 350 volt DC, output 235 volts AC, three phase to drive the three phase motor here. 1.8 amps, that's about 400 watts of power only for the fan, for one fan. The other fan has the same power. I just see that the modules here are labeled quite easily. Fast Ethernet, another one, That's the modules I just removed that go up to the CPU. Gigabit Ethernet, another one. Fiber connector 3, is that something IBM proprietary, or maybe it's fiber channel, I'm not sure. I don't have so much experience with the IBM. ESCon, airflow, so these are only empty spaces. Funny connectors here. Loopbacks probably. Another loopback here. For whatever reason. Okay, let's take the boards out and have a look at it. So, let's have a look at some modules. Not too much inside, a big chip with a heatsink, another big chip, and some voltage regulation. This module was to connect the CPU through the cable here with the I/O card box. This is called the STI connector or STI bus. Goes up to 2.7 gigabyte per second. We have two of them. So that's now the Gigabit Ethernet module, that one here. It has two Intel Gigabit fiber network cards. Manufactured for IBM by Intel. So, thank you. Then we have some bus interfaces. I'd say that some PCI bridge chips, a little bit of memory probably, or flash RAM. The same white chip as on the other board, that's probably for the bus interconnect. Well, next one is the fast Ethernet module. Normally that means it's a 100 megabit Ethernet. It doesn't look so different from the other one. I think it's almost the same, but we have different cards installed. There are also Intel network cards, but with a copper interface, not an optical interface. Yeah, that's it. And this one is called the ESCon, whatever that means. So this looks like entirely made by IBM. They even have their own chips here. Five, four of the same types. We have the fiber optic interfaces here. That strange little white chip here, which we can find on all these boards. Another one that goes, seems to go directly to the bus. And not very much else. So I think this is just an interconnect something, maybe to another machine, with some parallel buses here. I don't know, maybe you can find something, some information about that. Now, if the CPU is the brain of the computer, this one is the heart. It's the oscillator unit, one of two. As I said before, they have two oscillators for redundancy. Let's see what's inside here. Well, not so much. There is, of course, a crystal oscillator. It's a 16 megahertz, which is not very much. So I don't think this is the oscillator for the CPU itself. It's more a clock system for the entire machine here. Another white chip and two driver chips, and out they go. Here is a space that looks like for a bigger oscillator. Maybe you can have this with some, I don't know, rubidium oscillator, so I haven't seen that in the manuals, but there are always options. Maybe it was planned to have something like that. Some test points here, a lot of them. Well then, it's time to clean up. I think we have seen all the bits of that machine. So let's do a last go around. And thanks for watching.